enforce like the gold standard for checking patients for atypical cells in their cervix is a liquid pap smear. So from a liquid pap smear, you may get atypical cells, which could be precancerous, or you may get cells that are squamous cells. Squamous cell carcinoma is the most common type of cervical cancer that one can get. Like pretty much 90-95% of cervical cancers are squamous cell. So it's important to understand that that is like one of the most important histologies of cervical cancer, which would be right in line with probably one of your areas of concentration. Okay. Is a squamous cell carcinoma being one of the most common types of cervical cancer. Now furthermore, when you talk about cervical cancer, it's much different than any of the other cancers you typically talk about, because surgery is not the gold standard in patients who have stage 2 and stage 3 disease. Now you can do surgical intervention in patients who have stage 1, but in stage 2 and stage 3, we do something called brachytherapy. B-R-A-C-H-Y therapy. And I'll pull up the hand that this will have a little bit better gauge of So surgery, not necessarily something that we do very frequently. The preference, if you see once a patient has up to stage 2B, stage 1B2, the recommendation is actually to do the external beam and brachytherapy in combination with chemotherapy. So that's one of the most important things to know about cervical cancer, that surgery, while it's an option if you have early stage, there are scenarios when you get to either stage 1B2 or 2B and above, that you actually want to do radiation and chemotherapy and no surgery, okay? Now, when we're talking about radiation and chemotherapy, the drugs that you guys, we're not adding any new drugs to the party. So we had our drugs we talked about. The drugs of choice here is cisplatin. We talk a lot about carboplatin, but this is cisplatin when we're talking about cervical cancer, okay? So only one dose for cervical cancer do you need to know. Okay, one dose. The dose is cisplatin, 40 milligrams per meter squared. 40 milligrams per meter squared. So I got a marker. Give a marker. Milligrams. Sure, that's another six flag. I'm about to briefly touch on that so you understand why I wrote it like that. Okay. So the reason I wrote it like this is because external beam radiation is one thing. The brachytherapy is another thing. So there's different ways to deliver energy to the area where the cervical cancer resides. But the cisplatin stays consistent. So external beam radiation means the beams are coming from the outside. Let's say this is a cervical cancer tumor. The radiation beams are coming from the outside, right? And they sit the patient in the machine, and they have the machine rotating around and delivering energy specifically to the cervical cancer tumor. Okay? That's the external beam. Brachytherapy, on the other hand, we still have the same cervical tumor because this is at the end. This increases the amount of radiation that can actually get to the cervical cancer tumor. They put rods right next to the cervical cancer tumor, and then they radiate the rods, and then they emit more energy right around the cervical tumor. Much more energy here than what you get here. But you can only do this for a shorter period of time. So it's just two ways to get radiation, and it boosts the amount of radiation that's given to the cervical tumor when you're giving brachytherapy. This cisplatin dose is what we call a radiation sensitizing dose. So it's not a therapeutic dose. It's actually not even there to actually give chemotherapeutic effects or cytotoxic effects. It's more like a broom. The radiation is supposed to weaken and damage and kill a lot of the cancer cells. The cisplatin is supposed to help move the cancer cells into the cell cycle where they're most sensitive to the radiation. And if you have a cancer cell that witnessed a sublethal dose of radiation to where they're weakened and they're dying, but they haven't died yet, the chemotherapy comes around and, sweeps them up. Okay? Or if it's a cervical cancer, that's essentially your responsibilities on cervical cancer. You need to know the functionality of cisplatin. You need the functionality of this, not even this detailed radiation, but the dosing of the cisplatin, the histology of cervical cancer, and then finally, we talked about a checkpoint inhibitor, right? What checkpoint inhibitor we talk about? Checkpoint inhibitor is the drug class of the PD-L1, PD-1 inhibitors. So which one is that?
Pembrolizumab.
So where's pembrolizumab used in breast cancer? Triple negative. Pembrolizumab used in triple negative breast cancer is actually also used in the adjuvant treatment of cervical cancer. So understand that pembrolizumab doesn't only have utility in breast cancer, it also has a utility in the treatment of adjuvant therapy in cervical cancer, okay? So don't limit it to just breast cancer. Breast cancer triple negative, but it's cervical cancer across the board in adjuvant treatment. Okay. I'm not gonna make you know the regimen, but I will show you the regimen just real briefly so you can see what I'm talking about. So, when we came in, they had the pembrolizumab, and we were really checking to see if patients had PD-L1 positivity, means we do an assay, and it'll show if there's a PD-L1 expression, okay? So now, you fast forward, and this is the most recent guidelines that we just released, these studies we just done, which is why I actually brought the papers out on you. I think how many of you got on here. This one's not as bad, but I think this one's probably only like 90-some pages. Cervical cancer guidelines is 96. Yeah, so it's not as long as the other. But if you go down to the treatments now with the most recent version in 2023, you'll see that the pembrolizumab has now been added as a recommendation for the adjuvant treatment. So, we're talking about chemo radiation. Of course, we're talking about the cisplatin or the carboplatin patients who can't tolerate the doses of the cisplatin, because cisplatin causes more nephrotoxicity, more thrombocytopenia, more neutropenia than you'll see with the carboplatin. Carboplatin, the only time I can argue maybe has a little bit more toxicity is maybe when we're talking about thrombocytopenia, but for the most part, neutropenia, nephrotoxicity, ototoxicity, because the platinums can cause ringing in your ears, it's all more prominent with cisplatin. Okay, they even cause neuropathy. So the pembrolizumab is one of the preferred agents when you're treating the first line for patients of recurrent or metastatic cervical cancer. And so that's where I want you guys to make sure you understand it has utility in cervical cancer also. And that's all I essentially want you to know about cervical cancer. And are those, yes ma'am?
Can you repeat that again? It's first line for recurrent?
It's first line for recurrent metastatic disease. And it's going to be used in combination with the platinum as well as taxanes and Avastin, but just understanding that checkpoint inhibitor does have utility in cervical cancer. So make sure you don't like write it out for us. Then it's only triple negative breast cancer. It also can be used in cervical cancer now. So anybody have any questions about this? Brachytherapy. Those are like rods that can accept radiation. Going unfortunately into the patient to be as close as possible to the cervical cancer tumor and delivering boosted radiation directly to the area where the cervical cancer lies.
Like the And you said cisplatin, what is the
purpose? What about cisplatin?
What's the purpose?
Oh, sure. Cisplatin is used as a radiation sensitizer. Has anybody in here got Gardasil 9?
Yes.
Y'all know what that is?
Yeah, HPV vaccine.
That's the HPV vaccine, that's correct. What else do you know about it? So, just for historical perspective, of course, you know, y'all have probably had y'all immunization department, y'all was talking about vaccines, but not only does cervical cancer, is it caused by squamous cells or squamous cells for histology, but it's actually a pathophysiological process of HPV. So, you don't really find a patient who has cervical cancer that doesn't have history of HPV. You're going to be able to identify HPV because the chronic damage of the cervical mucosa is secondary to the HPV being present. So that Gardasil vaccine that's been designed has 9 subtypes of HPV, 7 of which are oncogenic. So it's very important that you understand about the oncogenic strains, which is what I've pretty much tried to list here when I had the 16 to 18 years. This is how it started, because it's changed 3 times since it was released. It started as just 2, and then it went to 4, and now it's 9. But what you got to understand is that there's 7 subtypes in Gardasil 9 that are actually focused on preventing cervical cancer. Does anybody know what the other 2 do? Yeah. Y'all got the Gardasil, and they talk to y'all about what the Gardasil does. So in addition, the 16 and 18 are there, and some of these additional ones have been added to Gardasil 9, but the 6 and 11 are for genital warts. So patients can have 7 oncogenic subtypes that are protective, that the Gardasil 9 vaccine is protective against, as well as 2 of the subtypes that are associated with genital warts, which is HPV 6 and 11. Remember 7 and 2 to make 9, Gardasil 9. 7 oncogenic, 2 for genital warts. Any questions? Okay. It's going to sound real familiar on Monday. I'm just telling you. Okay. All right. So now let's do our breast cancer with you. Y'all going to tell me everything, right? Tell me everything I want to hear today. Let's
full of the fresh fry. Y'all work the fresh fry? Or y'all have working yet? I still working on it. Oh? So let's go one. Try this problem one. So we got BB, 42-year-old Hispanic female, saying 3B, who at home always says a positive, her 2 negative breast cancer, which is synonymous with what? Triple negative. That's correct. We got triple negative breast cancer. All right, and patient is 5'3", patient is 72 kilograms, and patient doesn't have serum creatinine, but we need serum creatinine. We're going to put serum creatinine at 0.8 milligrams. First thing y'all need to do with this patient?
Calculate
their BSA. Calculate their BSA. Well, y'all know what y'all want to give her. Y'all just calculate their BSA. Y'all want some information. Y'all just want the information. Y'all know y'all don't need. Okay, what's the BSA? 1.7. So BSA. I heard 1.79. You have any objection? Okay. Is there anything else you need? Percentage when we're comparing those two. 72 divided by 52.4.
37.
How many percent?
37%.
So that means we're going to need to do what? Now we know what body weight we're going to use for creatinine clearance. All right? more than one?
87.4.
You got multiple 87.4.
I multiplied the original weight on the adjustment.
I understand that.
87.4.
Thank you. 87.1?
Yeah.
Now we need to bring it back. And you need to tell me what kind of treatment this patient is supposed to get. Triple negative, stage 3. What does she need? We already got the dose of the pembro, it's already there. What's the dose of the paclitaxel we?
We're doing the
paclitaxel.
Oh, okay.
143.4. That's what I'm looking for. Okay. You said 140 what?
142.4.
143.4.
143.4.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
143.4.
143.4.
I got 143.3.
All right. Be very mindful. Not to confuse, I already knew when he said it the first time that he used 75 and not 80. What is 75 for? Taxotere. This is Taxol. Those are two different drugs. It's paclitaxel or docetaxel. Paclitaxel, the dose is 80 milligrams per meter squared. Docetaxel, when we do one of the other practice problems, it's going to be 75 milligrams per meter squared.
Okay.
Okay, so we got two doses now.
What's the AUC?
What's the AUC?
5.
Correct, it's 5. Did one not say 5 in class? Last time we were in class?
I thought you said 5
and 6. 6 was 4, 5.
Correct. 6 is for TCH plus P. 5 is for triple negative patients. That is correct. Okay, y'all got some more questions?
Yeah.
Because it actually, you know, these guys slapped this around. Because I mean, this is just now, if I say AUC of 5, y'all should be like 87 plus 25 multiplied by 5. That's the answer.
560.5.
So how long are they going to get this?
I'm sorry, what if the 560 comes?
What's the Calvert's formula?
It's 25 plus creatinine clearance times your AUC.
So you have to use the Calvert's formula when you're calculating the dose of carboplatin. When you use the Calvert's formula, it's going to be creatinine clearance, okay, plus the non-renal clearance, which is what?
25.
Solution to that, which is in parentheses, multiplied by the desired AUC, which in this case is 5. And that's how you get 560. had a lot. Okay. So how long are they gonna be on this?
How might be 4
Well, let's look at. So 87 plus 25, okay, is 100. It's like almost 150. Yeah, so like one. Yeah, so it should be 5. So this right here, this regimen, this lasts for 12 weeks. Then what happens afterwards? Do y'all know what happens afterwards?
There's another round of pembrolizumab plus doxorubicin and cyclophosphamide. The duration is the same as the previous regimen.
Still 200. What's this dose of this?
That's 60 milligrams per liter squared.
What's this one?
600 milligrams per liter squared.
And how long does this one last?
4 weeks.
How often do they get this one?
Every 3 weeks.
How often do they get pembrolizumab on that one up there?
Every 3 weeks.
How often do they get the carboplatin up here? What's the dose of the doxorubicin and cyclophosphamide? 60 milligrams times what?
1.7.
107.7. What's the one last thing we do here?
No.
How much time do you allocate for such a number?
I mean, we only give us
3 minutes. I mean, what I did, I can tell you what I did. It's not like I gave y'all like 40 problems like this or something like this. Not every problem is like this. And then one problem, it might be this. It might be the same patient with all of the same stuff. And I asked you multiple things about that patient.
Was that 5 questions on the exam? Or
it could be like, no, it could be like the same patient, and I'm asking you 4 questions about the same patient.
The same question or the next question?
It's like the next thing, like, you put boxes around it, like, you know, it might be like, you know, this is 1, and then this is 2, and then this is 3, and this is 4. And that's 4 of my 22 questions right there.
You're going to give us the formula?
Yeah, you're going to give us the formula.
Yeah,
okay. Yes, sir.
Okay, so are these questions, are they multiple choice or
multiple choice? I mean, unfortunately, I have this multiple choice.
Oh, so we can guess, right?
Yeah, so you can probably, you Probably, I mean, I know, I've seen the students in the exam, like, looking at the answer to the working back. I've seen it though. It really should be an open-ended question I ask you. That's what it should be. But I know how it is. So, there's multiple choice. You have to notice in my quizzes that I give you a layout. I don't like multiple choice. I want open-ended questions. But see, when I ask y'all open-ended questions, then I really get the answer of what you think it is. If I ask you a multiple choice, you can get it right. You get it right by accident, or you get it right by process of elimination. Either way, you don't really know what you're talking about. When I get a call about one of my patients, it's not a multiple choice question. They're asking me an open-ended question that I should have the answers for because I should know the answer. So I really don't, when you get in real life, there's no multiple choice. You know, so. All right, so y'all have any questions about one, and we'll do two and three. And then I'll wrap it up with anything on areas of concentration that I didn't talk about on two and three. Chris, yes. In this scenario, it's every 3 weeks, yeah.
And also with a cyclophosphamide?
Correct. So, anything? Nothing on this one? Okay. All right, so, we're going to make everybody like 20% or something. Maybe 50 more patients, number one. And even when we're talking about stage two and stage three and stage one patients, I'm teaching you guys 2 to 3 regimens out of 10. Because if you see my hand up, you notice there's a lot of regimens on there. All of those regimens can be used in this scenario. I'm just giving you the regimens that are most commonly utilized. I say it so you don't like leave like feeling like you really
no thank
you. He said don't get the question. like if you get a question, you don't know. So this is what I do, and this is why I asked y'all about the regimen in the first place. If I have a hormone receptor positive patient, they're HER2 negative, you want to choose your regimen first. You want to establish the patient's receptor positivities and negativities and choose your regimen first. So when you read through the case, the first thing you would choose your regimen. So what regimen that I've taught you guys would you use with this patient?
Dose 6 AC.
What would that be followed by? remember to give them to me. Tax all
and tax OT.
Okay, so what's the doses of dose dense AC? What about the cyclophosphamide? What's the dose of the weak Taxol?
80.
What's the dose of the dose dense Taxol?
75.
How often do you give the dose dense Taxol?
Every 2 weeks.
How often do you give the dose dense AC? How many cycles of dose dense stacks out, dose dense AC do you give?
4 cycles.
Four.
How many cycles of dose dense tax out do you give?
Four.
How many weeks of weekly tax out do you give? What's the patient's BSA? Say again.
2.06.
Is there a reason in reference to dosing that you would need to create the clearance? The answer is no. There's no carboplatin there. We don't even have any drugs that are like prominently renally cleared for the possibly adjusted dose for that fetch. Because you could make the argument, you calculate the creatinine clearance because you want to make sure that you need to make any dose adjustments to the chemotherapy secondary to renal dysfunction. But that's not even the case. So what we have here is a patient where you don't necessarily need the creatinine clearance, so you don't have to worry about the adjusted body weight and not your body weight because everything is going to be dosed. BSA. So now I know that I pretty much have dose of 120 milligrams, 1200 milligrams. I don't know, if, depending on which one I use, okay, you use like a dose dense regimen. We'll go over here with 350. But if we wanted to use the weekly regimen, we could have 160. See, now I just answered 4 questions on the test in like less than 30 seconds. Hmm?
Yeah, the answer is 2.
Yep.
That's why.
I mean,
make it
1.8. Make it one. Does everybody understand this part?
Right. Yes.
Yeah, are we good? Is there anything else? Maybe yes. Patient is 39, so I'm going to assume that she's premenopausal with no other information given. So I then have the option of doing tamoxifen for 7 years, or I can do an AI plus an LH. RH. Hey, for 5 years. And as I said, as things progress, you know, you can look at places that be like, oh, we need to study with 10 years, oh, we need to study with 7 years, oh, we need to study with 5 years of tamoxifen, with 5 years of AI. So there's a lot of different variations, but the 5 to 10 year span is what you always want to understand as far as optimal duration of therapy with endocrine therapy. And you need to know the menopausal status of the patient. patient P67. Prowess is enough for us to put them on Verzenio. The reason why it's 2 years in reference to Verzenio is because they've done studies to show that the recurrence of patients who are, it doesn't matter their pre-post or perimenopausal, when they're on endocrine therapy, if they do recur, it happens within the first 2 to 2.5 years of therapy. So that's the danger zone when they're having a recurrence, like when they start endocrine therapy. And that's why you add in Verzenio or abemaciclib in high-risk patients. If you notice, you get the abemaciclib 150 twice a day, and there's no breaks. The reason why that's important is because there's two other drugs, same class, that you give a 7 day break. So Verzenio is continuous. Okay, you don't stop. Only time you stop is toxicity, or you need to possibly hold the patient dose so you can change it to something else, a lower dose. Okay, so 2 years span, continuously given. Y'all asked about the P67, which is what you needed, and you know that they're lymph node positive because they're stage 3. Now this patient's therapy is complete. So they got dosed in SAC, they got dosed in Taxol, they followed it up after they had their surgery, we knew they were premenopausal. They got 5 years of the AI and the LHRH agonist on board, and the first 2 years is also going to be a bit of a cycle. You're always going to start with the chemotherapy or surgery, because we could have used surgery and then did all of this after surgery. We would typically, in a stage 3 patient, do the chemotherapy and then surgery and then radiation and then the treatment with the endocrine therapy, with the targeted therapy, CDK4/6. So, any questions about 2? Patient 2? Yes, ma'am.
No, just general question. When do we do the oncotype again? Is it before the
treatment? Sure. So the oncotype is indicated in this type of patient who is node negative. So they have early stage disease. So they wouldn't be a patient that would actually even qualify for the abemaciclib. They would be a patient that would possibly only get endocrine therapy. So we would pretty much give them endocrine therapy unless their oncotype risk recurrence score is high. Then we will offer them chemotherapy also. So it's only in stage 1 patients so it's like early stage patients don't have lymph nodes in their body. So you can, it can benefit early stage 2 patients also, but no stage 3 patients like what we're talking about. Okay? So are y'all ready to go to patient 3, or y'all have more questions? So Kadcyla can be used in hormone receptor negative HER2 positive patients or triple positive patients, but they have to have HER2 amplification. Yeah, Kadcyla. All right. Patient 3, we'll touch on Kadcyla. Any questions on patient 2?
whenever we have a patient case, mm-hmm. We just have the HR and the HER2. What about the ER and PR?
So, the way we look at ER and PR, they're both synonymous with hormone receptor. So, if there's any hormone receptors that are positive, then we consider them to be the hormone receptor positive. So, if you look at the pathology report, it's going to tell you that 15% of the receptors are estrogen and 66% are progestin. But when we're looking at treatment options, it doesn't matter if it's 10 and 10 or 5 and 5 or 6 and 7 or 8 and 12. If we say hormone receptor positive, we're going to use that endocrine therapy. Okay?
Because they're saying that if you are positive, you have to use some oxygen for the hormones. I don't know.
Well, so the way we look at it, even though, true enough, when you look at the positivity of the cells, you can have patients, which is a poor prognostic factor, actually, if the patient is a progestin receptor only positive. So those patients are typically harder to treat. But we pretty much treat everybody with endocrine therapy that's focused on the estrogen pathway. Even though there are not a lot of patients, but there are a few patients where they're hormone receptor positive, but they're predominantly progestin receptor positive. And the only thing we know about those patients, even though we treat them with endocrine therapy, is that they have a poor prognosis compared to a patient who has estrogen receptors that are positive and progestin receptors that are positive. So patient three. 54 years of age. Choosing now, triple negative, triple positive. What do you want to do with triple positive patients? Trade name for pertuzumab is Perjeta, P-E-R-J-E-T-A. But pertuzumab Perjeta still works. It doesn't lower Herceptin because Herceptin is tested in there, so you have to use the age. So what's the dose?
7.5.
What about the AUC of the carbon plate?
The
okay. What about the Herceptin? determine the calculation that you establish exactly what the dose is going to be for each agent you're going to use and the duration of each agent. Then you start calculating. That's the more efficient way to probably do this. All right. Still waiting to the exam. Nobody got an answer?
75.4.
75.4, anything? Is it anybody different? It'd be like 23 plus 2.3. 25.3 plus 45.5. Tell it to me. What is it again? 75.4. I can already tell. It's above 30%. So what's the what is the percentage you do 105 divided by 75? So now we got our adjusted body weight here. What's our adjusted body weight? 75.4 plus
87.4.
You said what?
87.4. 87.24.
Okay. Have any disagreements here? One other thing we need to do, that's calculate the creatinine clearance. Because it's 54 years of age. We're going to use adjusted body weight. Their creatinine is
110.72.
Somebody else get 110. Not something you have to know, but we typically max the dose of carbo out at 900. So if you do the math, you know that 900 means that the creatinine clearance is kept at 125 milliliters per minute. So you can actually get patients that are larger and younger, they have creatinine clearances that are calculated like 150 or 148, 170, not 175, they're calculated on that. I'm calculating them well above 125. If it ever goes above 125, we cap it at 125. So you should never get a dose that's above 900 milligrams if you got an AUC. Because the creatinine clearance should never be utilizing the equation above 125. dose of Herceptin, the loaded dose, 8 times 105.
840.
840, okay. Which is the same dose as the pertuzumab. What's the dose of the taxotere?
630.
Taxotere, 2.3 times 75. And what's the maintenance dose of Herceptin? And lastly, because the patient did have residual disease, what's the dose I calculate for the cat side? 105 times
378. Please.
Please.
Any questions?
Dr. Hannah.
Yes.
I have an issue with the IBW. Hmm? I have an issue with the IBW.
Which one you got?
The ID. I get 72.1.
You get 72.1?
650.
Well, I can already tell you. Oh. What you should have been, what you should use is 13. Yeah, 13. Because it's 12 inches plus another one was 13. So, y'all have any questions about patient three?
For Herceptin, you use the actual body weight and not
adjusted. Always. Mm-hmm. Yeah, any monoclonal antibody, actual body weight. Options for stage 2 and 3 patients who have hormone receptor positive, HER2 negative, triple negative, and triple positive breast cancer. All of which we just talked about just now. Patient 1, 2, and 3. Clinical indications of external beam radiation. Can somebody tell me what those are? Hmm? Clinical indications of external beam radiation in breast cancer. What do you say?
Positive margins.
Lymph nodes that are positive. BCS, breast conserving surgery, which is synonymous with lumpectomies or segmental mastectomies. All of those patients indicated that they get external beam radiation if they have breast cancer. Okay, calculating dose of BSA, weight, and calorie formula. We just did that. Know the toxicities of the platinum, taxanes, natural mushrooms, targeted therapy, immunotherapy, endocrine therapy. So, what do y'all say about platinum? That's the in chemotherapy. That's gonna be there.
Cardio.
Now with the platinum. I didn't put the anthracyclines on there, but yeah, that's a good cause. The anthracyclines are the ones caused the cardiotoxicity. Okay.
Nephrotoxicity.
So you think platinum, you should also always think nephrotoxicity. So nephrotoxicity, ototoxicity, okay. Neurotoxicity, and if we talked about the mild suppression, of course, is there also. But yeah, definitely think about nephrotoxicity, ototoxicity. What about taxanes? So bone marrow depression, which is more prominent with taxotere. When you're looking at neuropathy, which is another one of their really common side effects, that's more common with Taxol or paclitaxel.
when you're looking at you know, patients who have infusion reactions, then you're talking about paclitaxel also. We have to give patients steroids and antihistamine before they get treatment with paclitaxel specifically because they can have infusion reactions. What about nitrogen mustards? So nitrogen mustards, one of the most common things that you really hear about with them, of course, they can certainly cause patients to have bone marrow suppression. So you look at anemias, thrombocytopenias, neutropenia, that's there. But hemorrhagic cystitis is not something you necessarily see with these patients because the doses are a bit lower. But another nitrogen mustard, which is what? So cyclophosphamide is one, and another one is commonly used. It starts with the I.
Iphosphamide.
So iphosphamide causes hemorrhagic cystitis. So much so that you have to give an acetylcholine medicine. So nitrogen mustard, you should also always think about high dose nitrogen mustards and hemorrhagic cystitis. Okay, so with our targeted therapy, which our targeted therapy would be Kadcyla, Herceptin, and Pertuzumab. And then, of course, the CDK4/6 inhibitors are considered to be targeted therapy also. So we're talking about Herceptin specifically. What did I say is something we have to screen for initially? The cardiotoxicity. Okay, so they need to get an echo at baseline and they get it every 3 months while they're on therapy. Now, pertuzumab, it causes a gastrointestinal side effect. Y'all remember which one it is? Diarrhea. The Kadcyla is relatively benign, maybe cause a light amount of nausea and vomiting. You still do have to get the baseline echo because it is trastuzumab conjugated with antimicrotubule. Immunotherapy, we only talk about one immunotherapy. What was it? Immunotherapy. Checkpoint inhibitor. Pembrolizumab is a checkpoint inhibitor, it's a PD-L1 inhibitor, and it's immunotherapy. So with that being said, what did I say about the cascade across the body with immunotherapy, checkpoint inhibitors? Inflammation. Inflammation from head to toe. Every major organ can have some type of inflammatory process that decreases its activity or causes a problem in reference to a thyroid gland being inflamed, elevating the TSH, which is secondary to you having a decreased amount of thyroid hormone available, and will cause us to have to possibly do what? Start a patient on what drug? Levothyroxine. So those CDK4/6 inhibitors, like abemaciclib, what are the side effects we worry about with them?
Diarrhea.
So diarrhea specifically with abemaciclib. And then what's following the diarrhea?
Pneumonia.
Neutropenia. Diarrhea and neutropenia at the top of the list, those are the top reasons why patients possibly need to be taking out therapy in addition to fatigue. But you just want to make sure that you understand that neutropenia is a class effect, and diarrhea is specific to abemaciclib when you're talking about CDK4/6 inhibitor. So what's the significance of adotrastuzumab and tansin, which is the Kadcyla? When do we use it? Residual disease at what point there?
Adjuvant.
Well, remember, what happens is that you give patients the chemotherapy, neoadjuvant, then they come in, and theoretically, all of the disease should be gone. The chemotherapy, the systemic therapy should have got rid of. However, if there's remaining disease, even after they've gotten all of their chemotherapy, then they're considered to have a suboptimal response, and they have residual disease. That's when they're at a higher risk of recurring later on in their life, and the Kadcyla is more appropriate than Herceptin or pertuzumab. And that's what the Catherine trial proved. That's why I wrote Catherine right there in Catherine. The Catherine trial is a clinical trial that was completed by the drug company to essentially look at neoadjuvant treated patients who get Herceptin and pertuzumab for the year versus getting Kadcyla or adotrastuzumab and tansin for 14 cycles. And what was their durable response? And how how long do you keep the disease away? All right. What's the most common histology of cervical cancer? Squamous cell. What are the therapeutic options for patients who have stage 3 cervical cancer? So you want to do surgery on them? A total abdominal hysterectomy? Or what do you want to do?
Radiation
will what? You want to do external beam and what? External beam and brachytherapy. Being sensitized with the cisplatin. At what dose? 40 milligram or what? 40 milligram per meter squared. With maximum dose at what?
70.
What is the dosing, the duration, and the frequency of the cycle when it's being used in the early stage of breast cancer? Twice a day?
2 years.
2 years. Is it continuous or is it 3 weeks on to 1 week off?
Continuous.
Okay. What's the utility of bone modifying agents in patients who are postmenopausal who have breast cancer? And why is it important? What patient population is important and why is it important?
Postmenopausal.
Say what?
Postmenopausal
patients
who are taking
endocrine therapy causes an increase the risk of having osteopenia and osteoporosis. So the bone modifying agents are there to protect them from skeletal fractures when they're on endocrine therapy and they're postmenopausal. And we talked about the toxicity of immunotherapy and possible supportive care like thyroid hormone replacement that we might use. So what's the utility of pembrolizumab in breast cancer, and what's the utility of pembrolizumab in cervical cancer? Triple negative patients in breast cancer, okay. And then when you talk about systemic therapies with cervical cancer, in combination with chemotherapy and Avastin, you can use pembrolizumab. So it's now the preferred agent in systemic treatment of cervical cancer in combination with chemotherapy. And is the preferred agent in triple negative patients who have breast cancer in combination with chemotherapy. Do you have any questions? I cannot place this closer in front of you than I did.
Posted